We're entering week three. You're finally settling down a little bit. Everyone's added and all that kind of stuff. That's good. I wanted to point out, make sure, for example, you realize that points are linked in to the weekly pages. And where it's warranted, I'm trying to link in, for example, a base code that I'm planning on doing during class, even if I don't get all of it, so you can kind of look back and see what we're covering in lecture in terms of code. And there's some reading kind of things, of course. So, all right. Should notice the second assignment's out. And it asks you to write a bunch of different methods doing various tasks. In fact, this lecture code is sort of in the form of that. There's a main function that calls a bunch of little things, so you can look there for examples. Also, tomorrow's lab is going to be sort of in the same format. So you should see some examples of what we're looking for, and it should be, you need comments and stuff, it should also hopefully make some sense. My TAs reported that things were pretty quiet in office hours. So that first assignment was hopefully not too bad, but don't take that as a real measure of what's to be expected during the course. I was sort of getting started. But they are eager to help you, so make sure that you need help, that you're going and finding some time to talk to them or myself. We did see a couple of emails, and that's good. I'm glad you're trying that avenue for feedback. Any questions about that kind of stuff? Assignments and so on. Good? We're going to talk more about loops today, while loops and something called for loops, and things you can do with them, a little bit on scanners and so on. So let's review. So the while loop has a form, while keyword, boolean expression inside parentheses, and when it's true, these statements are executed until this becomes false, right? That's the basic thing. So check the condition, do the statements, check the condition, do the statements, check the condition. When it's false, skip over the statements, go to the next line, and do those. Let's do an example of some while loop and a scanner. So here's the problem. I want to take a string, and I want to form, take the initials, let's say this is a name of some kind. I want to get the initials from it. Okay, so if I have string David Johnson, it should form DJ. That does it, and we're going to call it for main to try with different strings. So I'm going to have a public static, and again, I'm going to leave this blank for a second, make initials. So what kind of data does this method work on? What do we need to know? What do we need to send this method to do something? What's like the input kind of data on this? It's always, you know, all these problems you have to figure out. What kind of information are we working on? What comes out? What do I do to solve the problem? So what goes into this problem? Into this problem here? A string, yeah. Big string, and we turn it into something. So string, and in the assignment we're calling that a sentence of some kind. It doesn't have to be a sentence in terms of a formal or grammatical kind of thing. It just means some sequence of words. And based on this description of taking the first letter of each word and returning it like that, what's going to come out of this method? Also a string, right? So we'll add that information into here. And so far, so good. Notice in the assignment, I had a lot of stuff like return that, That wasn't trying to say that's the answer. That's just trying to make it so that what we're returning is the same as what was specified here, and the compiler doesn't freak out while you're writing your code. So the expectation is that you're going to replace this with something that actually was the answer, not this sort of stand-in kind of value. All right, so we need to look at each word, pull out the first letter. So what kind of tool are we going to use to look at each word in this string? What do you want to use?
Scanner.
Scanner, yeah. So scanner breaks into tokens. Tokens are words separated by white space, right? So scanner, pretty bad of me to keep using S here for scanner. Mostly I do that so it fits on the screen or the slides. We should be more descriptive in our variable names, but there are certain conventions people use that it's okay to go ahead and remember, this is a scanner. We have to use the new operation, and that's going to create an object of the specified type. And we're going to build the scanner from a string, which is our sentence string, right? So we're going to pass in the sentence to the scanner. It's going to make this thing that can grab the tokens out of it, and we're going to use that to try to solve this problem. All right, now let's at least now try to grab each token and make sure we can do that, right? So we're going to use this while has next method, and that asks the scanner, do you have another token left? Do you have another token left, right? And each time, it just asks the scanner whether there's something available for us. It doesn't change the scanner, but it asks whether there's something ready. And inside here, sometimes it's good just to take it in steps, right? And I'm going to print out s.next. So I just want to make sure, first of all, now you can grab these tokens, right? You don't solve problems all at once. You solve them incrementally, bit by bit. So as you're coding, you should always be checking your understanding and know what's going on. And so just do stuff like this. And I'm still returning some blank thing. That's fine. So in main, now I want to call this method. I'm going to call make initials on David Johnson. I'm not even capturing the return answer here. So this is evaluating to whatever is returned out of this method. But I'm just sort of grabbing it and throwing it away right away. I'm not assigning it to anything because I don't care about it at this point. All right, so if I run this, we will hopefully see some output. Okay, so the David Johnson input string, David Johnson, output, first token David, second token Johnson, right? So hope they're all good with that. Okay, so we're making steps, baby steps. You're always trying to make a little progress in your code, but make sure you understand what's happening as you do it. So now the problem is, given a...
Now, last time I was just going to say the character input and the separate
tokens. Okay, we'll try it. Look like white space. So we have two tokens. And we want to grab out these two characters. Right? So, how do I grab a character? There's a substring which pulls out a range of characters, but there's also one that pulls out an individual character. Character at, yeah, char at. So I could do it like this. So it says character at index. Remember, index is counting these characters one at a time, which one we want, and we start at zero, right? So this is index zero. So I'm going to use a zero there. I also notice I kind of did this in a sort of terse way. I wanted to show you can do it. So how do you evaluate this long statement with multiple periods inside it? Well, we have a scanner here. We're asking it for its next token. And if I were to look at this statement, what does that evaluate to? So that method returns, that next method returns something, right? So what does that call evaluate to? A string. That's what next gives you. Scanner.next gives you the token added in the form of a string. Once I have a string, I can call a string method on that thing, right? So These kind of statements are a little confusing because it does collapse a bunch of stuff into multiple things. In fact, I want to break this out into pieces. So string token equals scanner.next, and then character first letter equals token dot character at 0. And then I can print out first letter. Okay, so these, those are equivalent forms of execution, right? One just sort of smushed it all together into one line. But anytime you have stacked things like that, think about what that first part evaluate to. Oh, I can apply the methods of that type, like string methods, to that chunk. So don't get confused by people that sort of string those all together. Now, if you're working on it, it's not bad to list it out like this, break it into steps so that people can kind of follow what's going on. If you go back and look at it later, you want to know what was happening here. But certain things are sort of so obvious that some ways that people tend to smush them together and not worry about it so much. All right, so you see how that works? Multiple dots, first of all, and then secondly, what I'm doing here, pulling the token, grabbing the first letter. Again, I call it first letter, but it's at index 0, right? So index 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, right? Starting at 0. So you see that count by 0 indexing. All right, if I were to run this thing, I get DJ. Yay, we're getting closer, right? So again, not that I saw the problem all at once, not that I tried to write the code all at once. In my mind, thinking about what do I need to do to get to this point? Well, I need to get tokens, I need to grab the first character off the tokens, and now what do I need to do? What's the next step, do you think? We don't have any answer coming out of this thing, we're just printing stuff out. Printing is not the same as getting an answer, right? So what do I need as an answer? What form is that answer going to take? A string. Now the problem is, I have a character here. And I have a character first time through the loop, and I have a character the second time through the loop, but I don't have a string anywhere. So I can't say, for example, down here, first letter plus second letter. I mean, I could try to do something like that, but what's the problem with this approach? What's that? It's always called first letter. In fact, I don't know if there's five letters, or one letter, or no letters. So it's hard, you know, I can't sort of take it out of the loop and figure out one at a time. So instead, I need to build up my answer each time through the loop. So the first time through the loop, I want to grab that first letter. The second time through the loop, I get the second letter, and I smush it out of the first letter, kind of build up the answer as I go. Okay, so this is a very common pattern where we're going to slowly build up the answer over time, and by time I mean each iteration of the loop. So to do that, I need a place to hold the answer. And when I first start off, I don't have any initials I've found yet. So I'm going to start off with an empty string. There's nothing in it, right? And then the first time through the loop, I'm going to add in the first letter. And the second time through the loop, I'm going to add in the second letter. And by the end, I should have the full answer. So to do that, initials equals initials plus first letter. Actually, I have to admit, my notation got a little funny here, because when I mean first letter, I mean first letter of the token. And down here, I kind of meant first letter of the first token and the first letter of the second token. So I was a little inconsistent in my notation here. But first letter means the first letter of the token. And I add that into initials. And I want to say what's held in initials each time through the loop, again, to check my understanding of what's going on here. And then I'm going to return initials. All right, so we start off. We have our sentence. Make a scanner out of it. I make this thing called initials. And it deals with an empty string. I grab the first token, David, I grab the first letter off of it, put it in first letter, D, and then I say initials equals empty string plus D. So the empty string plus D makes me a new string with D in it. All
Alright, so first time through, this is going to have a D in it. I loop. I still have another token. I grab Johnson. I grab a J out of Johnson. And then I add initials plus J. A D plus J gives me a DJ. Okay, so that's what a sauce pop. So, and then I return initials at the end. Alright, so if I run this, a little hard to tell from the output. This is the letter that's printed. That is the initial string the first time through the loop. That is the first letter from the second token. And then this is initials after it smushed those two together. Okay? Now, a lot of people don't like this kind of problem-solving approach because I made this thing called initials, and it's wrong. It's empty. And you sort of want to jump right to the answer and say, that should hold DJ, not empty string, right? And then the first time through, initials only equals D, which is part of the answer, but not the whole answer. And then the second time through, it finally has the whole answer. In some ways, you have to tell yourself to be patient a little bit. Don't expect your answer to appear, like, right away. The whole point of doing this loop is that we're finding the answer one step at a time and slowly accumulating the answer as we go. Okay, so this is a very common pattern. These kind of loops, you start off with something empty, and you slowly add something to it each time through the loop, and by the time the loop is done, the full answer has appeared. But I don't know. You don't want to break that. A lot of people resist that, breaking the problem down into those small steps. So you're going to have to get used to this. Now, I return initials. In fact, I should get rid of all this like testing system out stuff. And up here, I want to capture the answer. Up here, and then print it out. The answer. Okay, so now we've sort of more formally split up the work here. Make initials, only job is to compute the string that holds the initials. And we're returning that answer out of the method. We are capturing that returned value up here by assigning this method call, whatever it evaluates to this initials variable, and then we print out the answer here, whatever form we want. So again, we want to keep that output stuff kind of distinct from the computational aspect. I run this, I get DJ, and of course, I can run it again. There's some other string. I was trying to think of some clever acronym I could make that it would generate like on the fly, but I was like, print initials. And so if I run it now, so it works for both cases, right? Notice now we have the advantage of having this method that works on whatever we pass into it. So we can call it different times and different data, and it gives us a different answer. Again, that's the whole point of the method here, is that we can use it over and over again for different kind of data. Yeah?
If you were to put like a middle name in it, would it also work for that as well?
I could even do a middle initial, but now you're going to all steal my identity. Notice my email is deep.john, so okay, and the other thing notice is I've reassigned that first answer to that same variable, right? So threw away DDJ and put in DT and printed it out. So we can keep reusing the variable for different things. If I wanted both, I'd have to make another variable of different things. Also notice I do not re-declare initials here. It's going to complain duplicate local variable initials. In other words, there's two things that are called initials here. So I don't need to re-declare it, I just need to reuse it, right? Reassign it a new value here. So don't be fooled by that. All right. Happy with that? Questions on that? Yeah.
So when you have initials equals initials plus first letter, is there any advantage to using like the dot concat method? Is there any
I'm not sure. So there's a method on strings called dot concat for concatenation.
I'm just wondering if there's like a
I don't know if one throws different errors, or if possible, or what? I haven't really used concat very much. I haven't felt the need for it.
Yeah.
And notice we're also concatenating here a character and a string, and it's smart enough to know how to do that, right? It's not two strings. The other thing I actually want to point out real quick is that there's a different form. The plus equals operation is a common shorthand, and that means the same thing here. It means add this right-hand side thing to the left-hand side thing, change the left-hand side thing. So instead of having to write out initials equals initials plus first letter, very often do something like this. And again, it actually helps because we're avoiding the redundancy of having to type initials twice. So there's fewer places to make mistakes. If you're doing x equals x plus this, y equals y plus this, and maybe you're cutting and pasting and trying to change it, and you forget to change the y one, so it ends up being y equals y, or y equals x plus something. You know, you make some mistakes like that. This form, you can't really make that same kind of mistake either. So this is a pretty common, and it's a good form to use, and just get used to seeing it, okay? So this is the same as adding this to that over here. All right, let's work on a different problem. And for this one, I want to let's print all int and string. So if my string were David 12, Joe 14, I want to print out 12, 14. Or I don't know, I'm deciding where you should go. Either a string of those in it, or we'll just print it out. Okay? So somehow, you need to identify what's an integer in here, and only print those out. So let's do a little different thing in my example here. So I'm going to make a public static. What is this thing going to return? Well, I guess it's this is, well, for now, we're just going to print the value. So it's not going to return a value. It's just going to write output. And I'm going to call this print int. And it's going to work on a string that is a sentence of some kind. All right. So it looks like we're going to want to look at each element one thing at a time, each token. So in your mind, that, again, should mean some kind of scanner, right? And it's going to be a new scanner sentence. And we can certainly print out all tokens again. So while s has next, we're going to print out just like we had before. And that's now enough to test this. So up here, I'm going to make a call to print ints with David 12, Joe 14, Sally 16. I don't know what these numbers mean, but it's not bad to me. And if I were to run this, it prints out David 12, Joe 14, Sally 16. So we're getting all the tokens, right? Now the idea is we want to somehow print out the integer ones. How can I do this? Where are we from? So I want to use an if statement. I'm making a choice here of some kind, right? So an if statement allows you to make a choice. And let's make some sort of choice here. So if what is true, when do I want to print out the token? Okay, if the token's a number. And so we can test that, actually, as next int. And it tells you whether that thing we were looking at is an integer or not. In other words, whether it would be able to turn it into an int. So that's actually pretty easy, right? Now the weird thing is, it looks kind of confusing here. I'm saying like, while there's a token, and then if the token is an integer, I'm looking at it twice, right? Once I'm just saying, is there a token at all? And the second time I'm saying, if that token is an integer, do something special. And what should I do if it's an integer? I want to print it, right? Oh, actually, I already have that, so let's just use that. Okay, now I indented it, so it looks right. Okay, so this is going to print out integers. What do I want to do if it's not an integer? In other words, if I'm a token like David here. There's something to do? I don't want to print it, right? I still want to absorb that token and move to the next token that's available, right? So I still need an else here, and I'm going to call s next to get the next token. So we'll move to the next token, but not doing anything with it. I'm not saving that token. I'm not printing it. I'm just sort of throwing it away, okay? So I think this code's a little bit awkward looking. Maybe it's a better way to format. But basically, we have our usual while loop. We ask if that token that we're going to be looking at is an integer. If it is, we print it out, but we also move past it, right? So the next thing, no matter what token it is, moves to the next token available. So if it is an integer like 12, we say grab that string, print it out, we move on to the next token like Joe. Next time through, that's for the token. That's for Joe. Is it an integer? No, it's not. So we just grab that token and move on to the next one, and we're ready to try the 14. Okay, so this is a case where I think it's kind of, you need to be pretty clear what you're trying to do, and somehow trust the code to do the right thing if that's what you know you're expected to be doing like that. So here, print it out 12, 14, 16. So we grab the integers and printed them out, right? Threw away the other ones. What would happen if I didn't have this S next here? What kind of behavior would it have, do you think?
It would loop forever because the first time it says, okay, is there a token? Yes. Is it an integer? No. Then we go up and say, is there a token? Yes. Is David still? Is it an integer? No. Is there a token? Yes, David. Is it an integer? No. We're never moved past it, right? So you have to make sure in these while loops that you always have a next happening somewhere each time through the loop. And an if statement makes it easy not to do that because there's two possibilities. So both possibilities have to move forward. Well, so you want to, why not put it down here and be safe kind of thing? It's harder to make that integer decision at that point if you've already grabbed it. I could have up here done s.next, grabbed it as a string, and then done that like parse int kind of thing, integer.parseInt, and seen if it parsed properly or not. I mean, there's a way they could have done it like you're suggesting. In fact, it's not like the worst idea, but this is the way. Yeah, I'm a little uncomfortable with the structure, but it kind of highlights the two things you have to be careful in. Alright, so that seems to work. And again, the idea is you can probe at these tokens as many times as you want. As next int. I can do all sorts of little tests, but until you grab it with the next or next int, it's not going to progress at all. I also could have here done a next int and grab this as an integer, but since I'm just printing it out, I don't really care if I print it as a string or as an integer. So if I was trying to grab that value and do something with it, maybe I'd have to do something with an integer. Okay. All right. That's where you start the puzzle of programming sometimes, is you have this idea of how to do something in your head and you have to kind of translate it to code, and it's not always like looking back at that, I'm sort of like, you know, what am I trying to do here? It's not super clear to me, even after having thought about it and written it, right? But it's the way it gets translated in this particular case. Any questions about it? Question.
Would it be more efficient to put the while inside of the else statement instead of just have two while statements?
You have two whiles, you're likely to get trapped. You want to loop once over all the tokens, so you need one while there. Try to do another while. What purpose is that while having? You're trying to like avoid this next issue, right? But you're just sort of pushing it. You still need to test the if then, so you've got another layer of ifs, and then it's going to get kind of confusing. The other thing is don't always pass sometimes where you, I don't know, you can kind of write too much code sometimes. Now, both the scanner and the string have some similar kinds of behaviors that you can kind of look at it, string with substring or characteret, scanner with the has next kind of thing. But they're different beasts. You can't use them interchangeably. And remember that typically the string is going to help form the scanner. The scanner has specific behaviors that help us do certain kinds of things that the string doesn't have. And then the answers coming out of that scanner, the tokens, can be different forms like a string or integer, things like that. But you got to be pretty solid in your understanding of those. Those are two different beasts and they have different purposes, and they're just not the same thing. But it's going to be tempting to want to pretend they're the same. Different points. All right, so we're talking about loops this week a lot, and we use that for repeating chunks of code over and over again. And there are a few common styles of loops that show up over and over, and so we're going to learn a few here today and tomorrow. And we started talking about this a little bit last time, but for example, let's say it's my count, or do something a certain number of times, right? The while loop, it has a certain common form. So first, we're going to have some sort of counting variable, and so you often have to create that variable yourself. So you know, if you're counting something, that information has to be stored somewhere as the counting happens. And we're going to initialize it to the first desired number, in this case, 0. So again, the pattern is, right before the loop, we're going to have a counting variable, and we're going to initialize it with some kind of start value. We're going to have some sort of continuation condition, and if that's true, it keeps looping. And we'll talk about that in a little bit. Question, yeah.
Initialize your counter in that initial statement in the while loop.
Okay, so if I tried a couple things, while count less than 5, and you're trying to say something like int count equals 0? Is that what?
No, right where you listed count.
Oh, in here?
Int count equals, yeah.
We can have a for loop in a minute. Okay. Could do this down here, right? Because first of all, we're using it before player, and then secondly, we keep resetting it to 0 each time through the loop. So I'm glad that was exactly the question.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, let me talk about this whole compressed form in a minute here. And each time you execute the body, we call it an iteration of the loop. An iteration is not just testing the condition here. So it's how many times you actually execute the body of the loop, okay? So it can be a little different. And this keeps going until the continuation is false. Down here, I have some new notation, counter plus plus. That is shorthand for adding 1 to the variable counter, increment operator, okay? So you see that a lot as well. That could have been done as counter equals counter plus 1. Could have been done as counter plus equals 1, or counter plus plus. Those all have the same behaviors in this particular context, okay? You add 1 to counter. And again, the reason for having this is that it is a very common thing to add 1 to something, and once you understand what that does, it sort of is unambiguous, and it just stops you from making little mistakes, like putting a 2 there or something like that. So it's just a form trying to stop certain errors.
Would there be any difference in speed in the computer on all those?
No, most compilations would sort of turn this into the same underlying code.
there are certain things, like that could be, you know, anyway, you can get a little more complicated in which cases.
All right. Now, important thing with these loops is trying to figure out how many times the loop iterates, right? I mean, that's really the fundamental goal of these things, is to iterate some number of times. And you want to make sure you understand how that works. And the way to do that is to keep track. So we have counter equals zero. We're going to loop while counter is less than 5. And we're going to do something. So over here, counter 0. 0 less than 5, that's true. It does something. And then add 1 to counter. So when you get that increment, that turns into a 1. You go back up, check this. Is 1 less than 5? That's true. Do something. Add 1 to counter. 2 less than 5? Yes. Do something. Add 1 to counter. 3. 3 less than 5? Yes. Do something. Add 1 to counter. 4. Is 4 less than 5? Yes. Do something. Add 1 to counter. 5. Is 5 less than count? Is 5 less than 5? It is not. 5 is equal to 5. So it doesn't do something, and we stop. Now given this, how many times does that loop iterate? Here, somebody in here, someone want to?
6.
6, 5, here, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. But did it execute the body for that one there? It didn't, right? So you also have to keep track of do something. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The body executed 5 times. Okay? That's what iteration means. How many times do something happen here? How many times you tested this condition up here? It'd be different by 1. Okay, so this all seems sort of babyish. You write down numbers, like that's what computers are for, right? But when you're trying to figure out your own code, this is a very critical skill to be able to say, what's the value? When we do something, let's go. You gotta be able to work out in your head some small example. Not if I try to say, well, I'll count less than 5 billion or something, I'm not expecting you to do it by hand, right? That'd take a long time. But you can at least say, okay, if it wasn't 5 billion, but it was instead 3, how many times does it go and see if you can figure out the pattern of this thing. Now, it's very common we start with 0 and then do less than some variable. You do it in this form, that does tell you how many times the loop iterates. You have 1 each time, okay? So there's certain patterns you see, and it's good to stick to those patterns. If you always start with 0 and do less than some number, that number is going to be the number of iterations of that loop. As long as you're not doing anything too fancy to counter in here. Now, some people want to say something like, while counter not equals 5. And would that go the same number of times? It would, right? Because is 0 equal to 5? No, that's true. It's not equal to 5. That's not equal to 5. 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 So that would work the same. Anyone see any problems with that? Like, is there some danger here? What do you think? Well, is 5 not equal to 5? It is equal to 5, so that would be kind of false when it's 5 here, okay? So that's, what do you think about the dangerous aspect? Yeah.
If counter is modified, sometimes you over 5, it'll never
commit. Alright, so let's say all of a sudden I changed my loop, I didn't want to count by 1, I wanted to count by 2s. Then it would go 0, 2, 4, 6. It would never touch the 5 condition, and it would keep going 6, 8, 10, whatever, right? Okay, so in some ways, this thing, testing for an exact condition, is more brittle than this very general one of just saying, hey, as long as you're less than 5, go with it. So, again, there's some dangers in trying to be too precise with your condition. You're better off having like a bound on it like this. And you'll see more examples of that. All right, so, okay, we have our counter plus plus. Here, I got rid of my increment. So notice the difference between these two. I have the counter plus plus there. Here, I forgot about it because it's just such a little statement. Here, the counter is going to say zero all the time, right? Counter equals zero, print out zero. Counter equals zero, print out zero. Counter equals zero, print out zero. It's going to loop forever. When that happens, let me actually just show something real quick here. So up here, I'm going to make a quick infinite loop. Int counter equals zero, while counter less than five. Okay, and if I do this right, let's do it right first, counter plus plus, and then if I run this, we get all our other garbage from before, but now we're counting up 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, that's good, and it stops. And now I try to run it again, and we keep getting 0. Notice it's not just like 1, 0, it's like looping and printing it out forever and ever, right? I'm making a lot of zeros here. And the problem is, like, the program hasn't stopped, so what do I do? Well, there's this little red button here. It says terminate. And very exciting, okay? So that kills those infinite loops. And so it's very easy to make an infinite loop, and don't panic and, like, reboot your computer. Just hit that little red box there. Okay. So scary, but, and sometimes you don't know it's an infinite loop. Like, if you're not printing something out, it just sits there, right? And you're like, so stop it, add some print statements, try and figure out where your loop is happening, and then kill it again. And then fix it. Alright, so here's another thing. Sometimes people want to put that counter first. And is that illegal? Not illegal. This is going to print out 1 the first time because it starts off 0, 0 is less than 5, turns into 1, prints out the 1. So that's going to print out 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Might seem handy, but I'll just say this is that people are used to seeing these loops in certain ways, and again, it's not a law of Java, it's not a rule, but when you're working with other people, you should follow sort of conventions. And one convention is you do your action, and then you progress the loop to the next step here. Okay, so you have a loop like this, do the add at the end. A little harder with scanners where that next thing kind of intertwines the action and the next the progression part. So it's not a hard, you know, it's not hard and fast, but try not to do this. So people look at this and say, oh, we're starting at 0 and stopping before we get to 5. So they're expecting 0, 2, 3, 4, and all of a sudden it's doing something different here. So it's not confusing to you because you're not used to it, but it's confusing to everybody else. So try to stick to the plan. Now, these while loops count are pretty common. A lot of times you want to do them 10 times or 100 times. But there are a lot of parts to it. So here we have our different elements that are important. We have to initialize our counting variable. We have to have our condition to check whether we're continuing. And then we have our progressions of the loop part. And again, if you forget one, you have an infinite loop, or your condition is wrong, or you get a syntax error because you don't have a variable. Anyway, just all these parts to remember. So there's another form of loops called a for loop that tries to put them all together into one statement where it's a little clearer what's happening, or at least it's easier to see all the parts at once. So a for loop is in the form keyword for, and then inside parentheses, there's 3 subclauses separated by a semicolon. So the syntax of a for loop is different in many ways than other statements and takes a while to get used to. But basically, you just move each colored part to the different section here and you form it. So there's going to be some initialization where you can declare a variable, a counting variable, and initialize it to something. There is a Boolean expression that goes in the condition. You don't need the parentheses in this part here, even though I sort of indicated it with that box. And then you have an increment. And then there's a statement here. So the way the for loop works is does this initialization statement. It checks the continuation condition to see if it's true. And if it's true, it does the statements. Once it's done with the statements, it goes up here and does the increment statement. Then it checks the condition, sees if it's true, does the statements, of the increment, condition, statement, increment, so on, until this becomes false, and then it jumps over everything into the next thing that's available. Okay? So I think this is a little bit weird because we're used to sort of reading these statements and they go across, okay, assign this to this, print this thing out, and go to the next line, it's all fine. This thing is jumping around like crazy. Boom, 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 right? So it's like all over the place. So you have to get used to how this evaluates. But it evaluates exactly the same as this while loop. Initialize once. Check this. Do this. Increment. Check this. Do this. Increment. Exact same thing, right? It's just in one line instead of multiple statements in a while loop. So let's look at an actual float. So there's our actual while loop, and let's do the same one here for int. I'm going to call it count, just count instead of counter. Equals 0. Count less than 5. Count plus plus. State and body. Print out. Count. Right. Of course, I can work out. So here, let's give ourselves a little warning. Running for loop. And we'll do the same thing part of our while loop. While loop. And if I run it, we get the same kind of behavior in both of them. So we're in our while loop, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Running for loop, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, right? And the key here is trying to figure out again how many times this loop is going to go. We start at 0 and we stop when we're 5, so it's going to go 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. It's going to count to the 4, which is 5 iterations of the body there. Now you can change all these elements here. I can go from 4 to stopping at 17, and actually I can make this a more general thing. Add 3 each time. Right? And you need to be able to look at that and figure out how many times that's going to iterate. Again, the only way to really do that is keep track of count. So count is initialized to be 4. Is 4 less than 17? That's true. It does something, it prints out 4. Then it adds 3 to 4 to 7, and it prints out the 7. So this is like the value count, and this is what's sort of coming out of the console here. It adds 3 to count, prints it out. 4 less than 17, yes. Adds 3 to count, prints it out. I can't move this up. Adds 3 to count, prints it out. Adds 3 to count. 19, checks the condition, is 19 less than 17, it's not, it doesn't print anything out, and so it stops at that point. And I'm tracking the value, and again, we're not always printing out the, you know, the value is, so that's just sort of coincidence here, but it's iterated 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 times, and each time it printed out a different number. So you need to be able to look at these statements and figure out how many times they go. It's a fundamental like debugging skill of yours, because you're going to get it wrong at some point. Count by 2 is up from 3 to 100 or something like that. And you're going to make your loop wrong. So you need to practice that kind of skill. All right, let me do one more second of talking. Okay, so use for loops. It's called, you know, you want to count to a certain number. You want to count 10 times. For loop is a good form for that. Use a while loop when you don't know how many times you're going to go. So you can use a while loop, for example, you're doubling numbers, 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64. You can say double numbers until the counting number is greater than 100,000 or something like that, right? You don't know what the answer is yet. You don't know if you're going to be doubling 50 times or 100 times or how many times you're going to go. Instead, let the while loop handle it. Keep doubling until the answer is bigger than 10 million or something like that. So while loops, indefinite. You don't know how many times in advance. For loops, definite. You do know how many times in advance. But you use both to get a case. All right. Go to lab tomorrow.